of BIM HRD, feel highly honored to introduce Mr. Santanu Bhushan amongst us today. He holds a bachelor's degree in mining engineering from Bengal Engineering and Science University from Shivpur and MBA from XLRI Jamshedpur. He started his career with Hindustan Copper Limited as a mining engineer in the year 1989. He further joined Crompton Greaves as a personnel executive in the year 1995. Subsequently, he has worked in the Timken Company as head HR, General Motors as Director Human Resource, and presently he's serving as Vice President Human Resource at Schaeffler India. He is an analytical and result-oriented HR professional with 20 years of extensive experience in HR management and leadership. Furthermore, he has also contributed in multiple assignments across all of the areas of HR in Indian as well as MNCs with versatile exposure in organizational development, HR operational leadership, coaching in corporate human resources, as well as manufacturing HR. Sir, I welcome you with respect and reverence. May I please request you to enlighten us with words of wisdom. The dais is all yours. Thank you, everyone.
It started in 2006, And in last 10 years of the operations, currently Twitter has a follower of 385 million globally. And you'd be actually surprised that, you know, almost like per day, 500 million tweeters get exchanged. So that's the impact of the communication media of Twitter. So that's one of the changes what has happened in the last 10 years or so. 2007, Apple launched iPhone. And this has become almost like an iconic brand. And you know, I think some people die for it. Again, there are some other topics like 8 is Lehman Brothers filed for bankruptcy, which has got a huge, huge impact on the recession, which starts kicking in. 2009, because that's a big topic. You know, if you look at today, in any of the management conferences, if you go and you actually hear about the major trends which are going to impact the business, is harmonization. So 2009 is the first year when there was a study by World Economic Forum, and then they said that in that year, urban dwellers number is first time in the history has surpassed the people who are staying in non-urban areas. Similar, there are some other topics. I don't want to spend enormous amount of time on all these milestones, but the major message from this slide is we have been seeing some very major changes which is impacting our business world in a big way in the last 10 to 15 years. Second slide is something which actually is going to talk about what's currently happening and what's likely to happen in the next few years. Now, many of you probably has read this in the newspaper in a big way, that India has a big advantage from the demographic standpoint. We have so many young guys and girls who are about to join the working population. Whereas if you go to countries like Germany, and for that matter in the US or many other countries in Europe, even in China, because of their birth control, there is a huge disparity in terms of the number of people who are joining the workforce, and that's a challenge that they're facing. So this is one of the things which is a major election priority or factors in Germany right now. So that's one of the things which is actually changing the demographics leverage for countries like India and some of the countries in Africa, where we have a huge number of populations who are joining the workforce rather than who are retiring. Similar way, one of the important aspects in 2017, there's a country called Vietnam and Hanoi. And Hanoi is now becoming almost like a manufacturing hub. So there, one particular company, I don't want to take the names, is now experimenting with using some amount of sensoring mechanism, which is connected to the body of the people who are assembly workers, to look at the concentration of that person's walk rate and mood. So if you are not feeling in a good mood and had a fight with your girlfriend, probably your productivity might get impacted. So there's a study which is going on. It's unbelievable. But this is what exactly is happening in some part of the world. And why this is happening is that now, the organizations are going towards an extreme to try to control those factors to make sure that productivity does not get suffered. How many of you have seen a iconic movie called Modern Times by Charlie Chaplin? Okay, if you haven't, I would strongly recommend seeing it. You will actually find a similar kind of experiment which was done with Charlie Chaplin, and it's more of a when the first I would say machine evolution was going on. That was a satire on this, and it's a famous Charlie Chaplin. I'm assuming that you have heard of him. He's one of the world's greatest actors. Similar, I think probably one point which would be important for you to take a note of is 2020, because the way it's going all around the globe, number of jobs are getting really reduced, and therefore it's becoming very difficult for the university students to get jobs, and it is going to have an impact on us as well. So all this actually would lead to, in a futuristic world, four different types of organizations. So if you look at today, normally in the Indian context, you will find that there are two different types of organizations which are very much prevalent. One, we normally call it startups, and one which is a very mature company, which is running its own operations and has got proper systems and everything is placed. Both of them If it is in business, it has to make money. So there is nothing wrong about it, and there is no two way about this. But as we grow, what they are saying is that there is going to be an evolution of four different types of organizations. So one would be something which is more of socialistic organization, where the human values would be really valued in a big way. And they would probably compromise on their profit making in order to make sure that human elements are being taken care of. Second one would be more of a startup, which is called a RAID, and they are innovation rules. So it's a very interesting organization where you will really find that there will be all small, short-term teams getting formed within the organization. They want to make sure that customer preferences are being taken care of. Third is companies care for more of a sustainability. And fourth is the big corporates. So they will go for more of a consolidation and create big organizations, and they will ask for more important talents and make more money and be more successful. So these are some of the changes which is a little abstract right now, but it is likely to come in the coming days. And the reason why I have shared this is that this is just to make you aware that actually the world is not only for India. There are different walks which is happening all around the world, which will have an impact on our business model. Some of this, and now going to that, experience something called disruption. So any of you has got any idea about what disruption is, or any example from your subject?
Reliance Jio.
Yeah, absolutely. Somebody says Uber as well. So, you know, this is what is called disruption. So if you look at, there is a continuity. So normally we find that something which is very basic level of innovation is improving what we are currently doing to a delta. It's not a very big type of change, but it's something which is going to make things even better. Then if you look at, it's doing absolutely new things. And third is something called disruption. So let me give you some examples. So for example, innovation is the Google Map real-time tracking. So if you look at 3 to 5 years back, when we start using Google Map, you can put from Talegaon that, okay, I want to go to BMI HRD. So they will give you a map stating that this is the way you are going. And today, what they are giving not on their map, but they are giving different options. Some of the cases where it is more crowded, and if you want to really go and get some petrol pump on the way. So these are innovations. These are not big time changes, but these are innovations. Then somebody has talked about doing new things, which is more of Uber, Ola, Jio. These are the examples of new things, absolutely new, and you can call it disruptions. And most important is third one. That's something which is what we are thinking about. Because what's happening today is that many of people like you do not really want to buy cars anymore. Or they don't want to buy motorbikes anymore because they're quite comfortable in getting the Uber and Ola services. So what does that mean for business? Well, we are in the auto component industry. It's not a good news for us. Because if you don't buy cars, then the cars won't sell. And if the cars won't sell, I can't sell automotive components to those companies. So you can clearly see that how each and every activity has an impact on the business model. And therefore, it's important for people like you who are going to join marketing function of certain departments, or for that matter, HR systems and operations. It's important for you to really read that, study the trend and how this trend is likely to impact the business which you are in. I just share with you, and it's very interesting that only on last Sunday, I was coming back from the airport. It was late in the night, maybe around 11:30. So I got into an Uber. First thing is that within 6 minutes or probably 4 minutes, the car is there. That's a big plus for me because I don't need to really get my car driver to get my car and again be a trip. Then I started talking to that gentleman, and it is something which is really eye-opening for me. This guy, he is actually driving that Uber, and he does not belong to him. And I asked him that, where are you from? He said, I'm from Kolhapur. So I said, then whose car is this? Because my idea was that actually you need to drive your own car in case of Uber. So I asked him that, whose car is this? And he said, it's one of the regulations. And I said that, then what happened to me? Well, what happens, you know? Then he says to me that, sir, I have two cars. And those two cars are of white number plate. So I want to use those cars in Uber, but before that, I want to drive it and see for myself that whether I am fit for this business. Then I started talking, and then he told me, look at the, very interesting connectivity. He tells me, I stay in Piccadilly. So I said to him that, you know, it's late in the night. What do you do after this? He said, sir, I'm done and I want to go back home. And his home is at Kothur. Then he tells me that now I go back to Kothur, but I don't go empty. Someone who is in that software administrator would really look at my locations and alert me that what could be a likely passenger in the room. And then he started telling me that look at yourself. You don't need to do any gadget about your fare. You can see it directly and you will pay me without even asking a single question. You are happy. As a driver, I used to make 10 to 12,000 rupees in Kolhapur. I am making 30,000 rupees. I am happy. So it's a very, very win-win model. And look at how much is the penetration of your data. So everyone can see it and by which Uber makes 20% of his income. So it's such a compelling model, and how it's going to impact is something which you will be able to see in the coming days. And that's the reason, you know, probably some of the big car companies are directly working with Uber now. They are selling their cars there at probably a discounted price. So these are the impacts what you see in some of the innovations on the business models or on the processes. Other areas, you know, I would give you another example from the company side. Have you heard of something called Internet of Things?
Yes, sir.
All right, so I am actually in the company of a very learned audience, so its job is easy for me. So I'll just give you one example to illustrate why it and how it is impacting. So I was talking to one gentleman for a position in my company. He works for a company which is a German company, and he is the head of one business in that company. What does it do? It makes railway brakes. And what's his job? So actually, he is running, something more advanced like a data center. What is his job? He runs a team of 15-20 people. So these brakes are actually installed on the German railways. Think about it. These brakes are installed in the German railways. And through the Internet of Things, they get that data about how much mileage they are going, what is the brake performance, what is the likelihood of taking that brake, making an accident, and XYZ. Now, they not only use that data for the efficiency or the product improvement for their own company, but they sell these services to other companies who are working out of Germany. So, isn't it really amazing that, you know, I think an Indian data center is analyzing that data, using that data for their own product as well as for the other companies as well. So these are things which are likely to come to the future. A rise of smart machines and systems. So similar things, if you look at, there is something called condition monitoring. Again, it's happening in the manufacturing industries in a big way. Third is new media ecology. So just for giving an example in training, probably if you look at, even in the teaching also, the conventional wisdom says that you will actually have a teacher and they will have a physical interaction and talk to you, which is really getting changed in a big way. So gaming, electronic learning, e-learning modules, these are playing an important role in the coming days. And globally connected world. So I've just given an example of Germany and India. So there are companies who are running their data center, who are running their analysis portfolio in India for the whole of the world. So these are the changes which are called digitization. So if you look at what are the trends, first, as I talked about in the past, is disruption. Second is digitization. And third is most important is diversity. So normally, if you look, go and talk to anyone else about diversity, the first thing what they say is that it's all about gender diversity. Now, many times, I think I was having a discussion with your team just few minutes back, and I was asked a question, sir, what is your opinion about women in business world? So, you know, I think whenever you talk about diversity, that's the first thing that comes to your mind, number one, which may not be the entire perspective or entire spectrum of diversity. So when you talk about diversity, it could be something like a person like me, who is close to 50 and then talking with people who are just about to join a college, join an industry, who is 122 years of age. So we have a different kind of thought process, different aspirations, different expectations from the company. So how do you manage that diversity? So that's also a part of diversity. And when we talk about diversity, also inclusivity is also a very important aspect of it. So when we talk about the inclusivity, what we mean is that some companies do have a target. They will still hire X percentage of their populations as from different diverse perspectives. But how much do we engage them in the business process, how much do we engage them in the business decision making, plays a very important role for you to be successful. So that's also an important aspect of diversity. Crucial connections is that the attract diverse talent, encourage their participation, foster innovations, and the lead to business growth won't happen without inclusion. So what it says is that if you do not really include all these different diverse generations, you will not really get the best of their ideas, which is going to impact your business growth. So therefore, understanding that narrative only with the numbers is actually futile. So next part is that sustainability. So if you look at many companies has got a very clear objective when they talk about the sustainability, which is more of a green world, sustainable world. So one of the examples I put in is Levi's. Levi's has got, you know, if you look at, all of you wear jeans. Now, next time when you go to buy a Levi's jeans, you will find that their brand is replaced by a circle with red R, which is called a red cap foundation. So, probably you have no idea that what is that red cap foundation. So normally, when you actually join a company, what's the expectation? The organizations will take care of whom? Employees? Maybe families, right? Maybe society. What is the role of red tab in this whole engineering? I know probably you may not be aware of it. So this red tab foundation, what they do is that they actually create a fund. This fund is normally getting created by the different employees. And this fund gets used when a person retires. It's a very unique thing, you know, probably if you look at, not many companies really think about beyond retirement if an employee has a problem and how he supports it. So this is something very unique which Levi started out, and it is almost like 3 years old now and working very fine. And this is again going beyond the conventional concept of sustainability. Second, you know, I don't know, recently I just came across one item in the Facebook. So World Economic Forum now did a study, and they have identified almost like 10 cities where the number of car density is almost equivalent to that of cycle or bike density. So that's where, you know, if you look at, they're just trying to do it just to reduce the carbon footprint in the whole world. For us, close to India, if you look at, we are very closely associated with some of the institutions. Where we support not only with the money, but also with the direct engagements. So, for the future of leadership, if you look at many times, you will find that normally when we have or when we go through such best practices sharing sessions, we immediately start thinking that how we apply them. And here is one caution note from my side, from my experience I can tell you, is that you need to really think about that, how much this is relevant for your context. So, you know, if you look at certain things which are running very good in Google or you know, in Apple, and if you want to really apply it in a family and manufacturing organizations in India, it is not that succeeding. So first of all, you need to find out that how do you find that context is right. Second is, of course, customer service. I mean, in your case, probably sometimes your customer could be employees as well. Some cases it could be an external customer. So if you want to introduce something, you need to really think through that, how it is going to be helpful from a customer or employee centricity standpoint. cost is a very important element. And finally, look at where it's going to improve the efficiency of the organization. So these are some of the impacts on the leadership style. So what are some of the demands for the future? I would say that, you know, you will always hear about everyone talking to you about being more efficient, being more cost conscious, everything. What aspect we are gradually missing out, which is very important, is empathy, not sympathy. So I mean, we always show sympathy to some people, but empathy is slightly different. So you need to really think yourself and put yourself in the shoes of that person, that how this whole experience is going to be different for him. So that's where the empathy comes in. Second is something known as Rashomon effect. It's Gapley's word. What it says is that it's nothing but if you look at nine from two different sides, it can be something which is known as six, or it can be seen as something like nine. So your perspectives do define that interpretation of the same situation in a very different manner. So therefore, it's very important that one needs to really, really understand the perspective before react, which is what we find that many managers don't do. And third, which is also very important, is logically versus emotionally. So all of us are really actually tuned to think in business in a very logical manner. Nothing wrong in that, you need to still go through and do that actively. But it's also important for you to know that what is emotional influence. And this is very, very important to be successful as a leader. So here at this juncture, I will actually share one video with you. Do you know this gentleman?
Yes, sir.
Who is it?
Steve Jobs.
Okay, I think probably he has an excellent video who talks about the culture of Apple and how collaboration is being seen in Apple.
One of the Apple's incredibly collaborative company. And so, you know how many committees we have at Apple?
No.
Zero. We have no committees.
No committees.
We are we are organized like a startup. One person's in charge of iPhone OS software. One person's in charge of Mac hardware. One person's in charge of iPhone hardware engineering. Another person's in charge of worldwide marketing. Another person's in charge of operations. We're organized like a startup. We're the biggest startup on the planet. And we all meet for 3 hours once a week, and we talk about everything we're doing, the whole business. And there's tremendous teamwork at the top of the company, which filters down to tremendous teamwork throughout the company. And teamwork is dependent on trusting the other folks to come through with their part without watching them all. But trusting that they're going to come through with their parts. And that's what we do really well. And we're great at figuring out how to divide things up into these great teams that we have and all work on the same thing, touch bases frequently, and bring it all together into a product. We do that really well.
Okay, so what did you understand about this say is, if you look at any company, it's a global company, Indian company, you have several teams working, you have several committees working, but there is a disconnect. And so there's a lady who says here that teamwork and understanding what each and every teams, how are they working, is very important. The other part is, someone talked about the trust, which is very important. And third, I think probably what is more important is for you to know, he used the word, we walk like a startup. So I think when you look at any company, when it starts up, there is a tremendous amount of speed in the decision. So So as you grow, then you create compartmentalizations, you create functions, procedures, systems, and then bureaucracy sets in. So most important part in this video so far is that he's talking that in spite of Apple becoming such a big global player, they have been able to maintain the culture of a startup. So the decision making is fast, and there is not unnecessary committee and the bureaucracy.
All day is meet with teams of people and work on ideas and solve problems to make new products, to make new marketing programs, whatever it is.
And are people following you along?
Yeah.
I mean, other than snarky journalists. I mean, people that work.
Oh, yeah. No, we have wonderful partners.
And do you win them all?
Oh, no. I wish I did. But you can't. If you want to hire great people and have them stay working for you, you have to let them.
What's the second most important statement here? See, there's a very simple thing you said. If you want to be successful, you need to hire great talent and allow them space to operate. Which is one of the biggest challenge in today's organization. So what happens is that if you look at many companies, they hire people, great talent, but probably they want a clone of that organization. So that's one of the most important factors of any of the great organizations, that you need to hire great people and allow them to flower, allow them to grow. So that's one of the most important factors. And he is very open in saying that I don't win all the arguments. So that's also another factor of any of the great leaders. You don't need to necessarily win all the arguments with your team colleagues.
You have to be run by ideas, not hierarchy. The best ideas have to win.
So,
otherwise, good people don't stay.
But you must be more than a facilitator who runs meetings. You obviously contribute your own ideas.
I contribute ideas, sure. Why would I be there if I didn't?
Okay, I think enough for this, right? Close this with one small slide for my HR folks. Again,
we have a question. One of them.
Who is this guy? Jack Wells.
Number one. I have the biggest number one. Many others think the answer is success. HR is the driving force behind what makes a winning team. We make the argument that the team that fields the best players wins. HR's involved in making sure we field the best players. That's their job. And their job is to sit in every meeting, be involved in every part of the business equation. They're not the health and happiness, picnics, benefits team. They're the development team, developing today's and tomorrow's leaders. And if you have an organization where HR is relegated to forms and benefits, you got the wrong game going. I like to use one analogy. If you were running a sports team, whether it be the New York Yankees, Boston Red Sox, would you like to hang out with the head of player personnel or the team accountant? Who would help you?
Somebody asked me when I was there that what's going to be HR's job, or why should someone really respect HR professionals in the business? I think the answer is here. Clearly states that one of the biggest jobs for the HR guys is going to be a development partner. So all of you both who are in the HR functions, keep that at the back of your mind, that this is going to be one of the most important factors for you to be successful in business. Thank you.
The floor is now open for questions. that in the near future, the merger and acquisition of the company is a roadmap for diversity. If mergers and acquisitions are going on now, and in the near future, it's 2021, if you are telling about the jobs will not be there, so would that be the road to diversity?
Well, you know, I think merger and acquisitions, if you look at normally, most of the companies, what they look at is that what benefit do we get? Now, there is one saying which is becoming more and more prevalent, is that you look at your people, you don't look at all the jobs. So, therefore, if there is a situation when merger makes some portion of your people redundant, some of the forward-thinking companies, they are providing them retraining and they are providing them some job opportunities. So now from today to tomorrow, it's not going to be a scenario where people will be really want to leave the job or outside the company. But having said that, we have to keep in mind that there is no way one company can carry on carriers. So there will be a situation some people require to be going, but how do you make it human is something we need to do.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I wanted to ask about gamification, like it's coming into HR in terms of training and employee engagement. So what is your view on it? Like, how will it help the organizations to improve its functions in terms of training or employee engagement?
Well, I think it's not a choice anymore. You know, I think if I look at scenario, this is becoming more and more prevalent. And it's also being driven by the millennial generation. So if I look at a scenario where you would be given that you know, that flexibility, that you can do your particular course at your own pace, you would always like that rather than, you know, actually sitting through a particular classroom session right through the day for 3 days away from work. So there is a business sense for it. It gives a lot of leverage from that angle. Plus, it's more exciting because, you know, I think gamifications, if you look at some of the companies, they are using it. It's really exciting through different kind of games. So this is going to really be prevalent in the coming days more and more.
Deception, at its core, is a really powerful idea. To learn about management or the corporate world, one should not rely only on books. It can also be gained from observing and interacting with people or scenarios. Thank you, sir. Today from you, we have learned a lot about leadership, a lot about disruption. We hope your insights will keep us ahead in our career path.